Tina, please speak. Hello, Tina.
Yeah, I can hear you. I can hear you.
Yeah, we can hear you clearly. Yeah.
Okay.
Sure. We'll just start in another 2-5 minutes.
Okay.
Hi, George. Long time. Hi, Kurian.
How are you?
Oh, good. Yeah.
Can you see me?
Yeah, I can see you. Yeah, I can see all of you.
Can you hear me?
Yeah, of course. Yeah. When did you come?
Oh, we came in late of last year.
Oh, last year, Lender. Yeah, okay, good. Yeah. Okay, yeah, not seen you around.
Settling down COVID. In the new house.
Okay, COVID times also, yeah?
Yeah, I know.
You don't get. Yeah. Hey, Kurian, how are things? Long time.
Where are you now? You're speaking from Mayflower, huh?
Yeah, I live in Mayflower, yeah, correct. I work in Tirumala Mission Hospital.
Yeah, I know that. That I know.
Yeah.
I thought you were speaking from there.
Hello, yeah. Naru, we joined, Panlea? John.
No, I have not joined anywhere.
Apriya? Okay. So, what are you planning to do with your time here?
We will decide. Enough time to decide.
Okay. Yeah, fair enough.
I was saying, yeah. From the age of 6 years, I've not had such a leave more than 60 days in my life. From the first standard, we never had a leave more than 60 days.
You are looking relaxed. That is good.
That's.
Hi, Ravikar.
Hi, Tanya. Hello, sir.
I can't see anybody.
நாலு பேர் தெரியுதே பாங்க அங்க you have to go and click on something
one of the something
yeah click on many things and then see which one shows the maximum number of people
there if are I click on something
see right at the bottom
click the participants
number of lamp like thing each one is an individual I think right
each one is an individual
Each one has to turn for the person to be visible. Many so people haven't turned the video on.
Which is Ravikar's one? I need to listen to him.
Ravikar.
Sir, you will be able to listen to me, sir.
Oh, good. I can listen.
Yeah. Yeah, to unmute. Unmuting, you have to press Control Shift and M. Then it unmute. I just figured it out. Yeah.
And for muting?
For muting, I think they decide when to mute you. Right? So the host has the ability to mute anyone he wants to. Okay. That's a good feature. Yeah.
Samuel, sir, another 30 seconds. Sir.
Okay. There are 22 people. Huh?
Plus 40, sir.
40 some. Okay.
40, sir. Yeah.
All right. Everybody, you cannot see everybody, I think. There's one method to see everybody also. I don't know how that is.
Yeah.
That's Korean,
eh? So,
Korean, da.
So, you can, so yeah. Koreans, Korean, we need
Korean,
a light
Korean,
on you, sir.
You are backlit, pa. You put the light in front.
Okay, I'll put out.
Yeah, light behind. Is, your face is appearing dark.
But I have in the office, that's why. I don't have control. Okay,
let me. Yeah, this is better, sir.
It's a little better now. Better. Yeah, yeah.
So, shall we start?
Yeah.
Okay.
4 o'clock.
Good evening, friends. On behalf of the Department of Medicine from Christian Medical College, Vellore, I would like to extend a very warm welcome to each one of you who have joined for this academic feast of the first Clinical Pathological Conference of 2021. Most of the feast is following some slaughter, which may happen, which is not the appropriate term, but I guess we are going to enjoy this time. A part of a learning process as we go through this CPC. I want to thank Dr. Don Kuruvilla, who has been coordinating the clinical meeting and the CPC for 2021 on behalf of Medicine Unit 4. And I really appreciate his hard work for all the work that he has put in and a lot of innovative things and ideas that he's incorporated it. I also want to thank Dr. Tina George, Associate Professor in Medicine Unit 2, who has provided the case for the CPC today. And the case will be discussed by Dr. Ravikar, Associate Professor in Medicine Unit 1. And I hand over this time to Dr. Tina George, who will be the chairperson for today's CPC. Over to you, Tina.
Welcome, everyone. Nice to see all the senior faces. Thank you for coming, sirs. Without further ado, let's start. Hopefully, I don't think this is going to be a slaughter, Dr. George, but I think it's going to be a lot of fun. Welcome, everybody. I'd like to give the stage now to Dr. Ravikar, who's an associate professor in Medicine 1, who will be presenting and discussing the case. Over to you, Ravikar.
Thank you so much, Tina. I'm just waiting for the slides to come up.
Maybe while you're waiting, I'll just give a little bit of background on this patient just to start off. This is a patient that was with Medicine 2 early last year, just in the pre-lockdown period. So the lockdown has had something to do with the case as well. I think Ravikar is sharing his slides now. Over to you, Ravikar. Thank you.
Thank you again, Tina. I have divided this presentation into four major sections. In the first part, I will summarize relevant clinical, laboratory, and radiological findings from the case. In the second part, I will be discussing the pathological diagnosis. I will then list out etiological differentials and discuss them. And then in the fourth concluding part, I will discuss the likely final diagnosis. So moving on to the first part, which is a summary of important clinical, laboratory, and radiological details from this particular case. So this is a 42-year-old senior social worker from Jharkhand who is affiliated with an NGO that works with slum dwellers. He presented with a history of a painful progressive left inguinal swelling spanning a period of 3 months between September 2019 and December 2019. He denied a history of genital ulcers or urethral discharge during this period of time. Now, during the initial part of his illness, he was treated empirically with a course of intravenous antibiotics, but there was no therapeutic response and his illness continued to worsen. He therefore sought medical attention once more in the last week of December 2019, at which point a left inguinal mass excision biopsy was done, and this revealed a granulomatous lymphadenitis. Now, mycobacterial culture reports from this period of time are unavailable. He was initiated on anti-tuberculous therapy. However, he failed to adhere to treatment and stopped the TB drugs within a few days of having been started on them. 1 month later, in January 2020, he observed that the pain and swelling in the left inguinal region were worsening. He also observed that the surgical biopsy site had broken down to form a chronic non-healing ulcer, which was persistently discharging purulent material. And he also complained of a painful restriction of the left hip joint, which was impairing locomotion. During the same period, he was noted to have intermittent episodes of high-grade fever with chills. He also complained of a loss of appetite. There was unquantified weight loss. This patient was subsequently treated with multiple courses of antibiotics over the next 2 months, that is between January 2020 and March 2020, but to no avail. He continued to have persisting symptoms and was eventually referred to CMC for further evaluation. This is a summary of his presenting complaints. Now, it is important to note that this patient does not have a history of diabetes mellitus. He does not have any history suggestive of underlying chronic liver or kidney disease. There is no previous history of him having undergone an organ transplantation. He denies the use of alcohol, tobacco, or recreational substances. There is also no history of chronic long-term immunosuppressant use or radiation exposure in the past. There is no history of contact with animals or birds, and there is no history of recent travel. His general physical examination was significant for low-grade fever. He was noted to have a temperature of 100.8 degrees Fahrenheit. His vital parameters otherwise were stable. He also was noted to have pallor, but there was no icterus and there were no palpable lymph nodes. An ENT examination was negative for oral ulcers and there was no tonsillar enlargement or salivary gland enlargement. And an examination of his genitalia and upper rectal examination were entirely normal. Now, on local examination of the left inguinal region, this revealed a 6 by 4 centimeter transversely oval ulcer with a deep cavity and a malodorous purulent discharge. The floor of the ulcer was covered with unhealthy slough and the edges of the ulcer were irregular and undermined. The area around the ulcer was indurated and tender. It is important to note that there were no other cutaneous lesions of any form that were found elsewhere on this patient's body. On local examination, he was also noted to place his left hip in a semi-flexed attitude, and he also complained of pain on both passive as well as active left hip extension. There were no clinical abnormalities on either of his lower extremities, and physical examination did not reveal any osteoarticular lesions involving the skull, the spine, or the appendicular skeleton. His systemic examination was remarkable for a systolic murmur in the upper left border, sternal border. Respiratory examination, examination of the abdomen and nervous system exams were all unremarkable. Now, when we look at his laboratory investigations, his hemogram showed the presence of a normocytic hyperproliferative anemia, which could possibly indicate a red cell breakdown, a possible hemolysis, but a DCT is not available. The other important abnormality that we can see from this table is some degree of hyperferritinemia, which could possibly be because of the underlying systemic inflammatory process, but his other hemogram components are largely normal. On biochemical investigations, he had an elevation of serum LDH levels. Again, this could indicate possible increased cellular turnover. However, the serum uric acid levels were normal. There was no serum transaminase elevation. Calcium phosphate and creatinine values were also within normal limits. Now, blood-borne viral screen was done. This was negative. And other serological investigations, including C-ANCA, P-ANCA, ANA were negative. And he had normal serum complement levels as well. Now, on imaging, a chest X-ray was first done. This did not show any significant radiological abnormalities. An echocardiogram was also done, which was largely normal. Specifically, there were no valve vegetations and all valves had a normal morphology. Now, subsequent to these two investigations, a CT of the thorax, abdomen and pelvis was obtained. This was significant for the presence of multiple rounded pulmonary nodules in the upper lobes bilaterally as well as in the right lower lobe. Now, these nodules had a soft tissue density and there was one nodule in the anterior segment of the right upper lobe that showed early cavitary changes. The nodules had a random pattern of distribution. There were no satellite micronodules. There were no centrilobular, subpleural or septal nodules seen. The tree in bud sign was negative and there was no pleural effusion. You can see one of these nodules in this particular image. This actually shows the nodule in the anterior segment of the right upper lobe, which in certain other cuts showed changes that were suggestive of early cavitation. Now, the imaging of his abdomen was significant for hepatosplenomegaly. He also had multiple ill-defined rounded hypodense lesions, which were scattered throughout the parenchyma of the liver and the spleen. And this you can see in the image on the left side. There was no ascites and there were no omental deposits. The images of the pelvis revealed left-sided para-iliac and inguinal nodal masses. These can easily be seen on these two images. This is higher up in the pelvis where you can see that there is a para-iliac mass which is abutting the urinary bladder, and much lower down there is an inguinal mass. And these masses were associated with Waldorf collections. And these collections were found to be in close proximity and virtually indistinguishable from these nodal masses. The collections also were noted to be encasing the left external iliac and femoral vessels. The other important finding that you can see on this image on the right is the presence of the non-healing ulcer. This is the left inguinal ulcer, and there was a sinus tract that could be made out in other cuts that was tracking down from the surface of the skin to the underlying Waldorf collection in the inguinal region. That is this collection here. And this collection in turn communicated with the much larger collection in the left para-iliac region. Another important finding noted on imaging was that there was a loss of fat plane between the para-iliac collection as well as the underlying psoas muscle. Now, in addition to these three major findings, the patient was also noted to have on CT scan multiple enlarged lymph nodes. The important lymph nodes that were involved were the left supraclavicular node, the highest mediastinal nodes, the diaphragmatic nodes, the lesser omental node, the para-aortic lymph nodes, and all of these lymph nodes had sizes ranging between 1 to 2 centimeters without any necrotic changes within them. Additionally, the patient also had an eccentric wall thickening, which involved the fundus and the proximal body of the stomach along the greater curvature with no significant perigastric fat stranding. He also was noted to have thrombosis of the left external iliac, the common femoral, and the visualized part of the superficial femoral vein, and there were no sinister lytic lesions of any of the visualized bones. Now, subsequent to this imaging, the patient underwent a few diagnostic procedures. Because of the presence of the eccentric thickening of the gastric wall, he underwent an upper GI endoscopy, which was a normal study. A biopsy had been taken, which only showed the presence of mild chronic gastritis and mild glandular hyperplasia. A bone marrow biopsy was done, which showed cellular marrow with trilineage hematopoiesis. There were no other specific lesions seen. He also underwent a biopsy of the left inguinal lymph node, which shows the presence of multiple ill-defined histiocytic aggregates without any caseous necrosis, and special stains for acid-fast bacilli and fungal organisms were negative. There were 3 blood cultures that were done. All of them were negative, and mycobacterial and fungal cultures of both the bone marrow specimen as well as the inguinal lymph node were again negative. So this is basically a summary of the important findings, clinical, laboratory, and radiological. And in the next section, I'm going to discuss the likely pathological diagnosis, and I'm going to do so by categorizing all of this information into 4 major problems. Now, if we look at it, the first problem that this patient has is the presence of multiple enlarged lymph node groups. And if we remember from the images, the 2 major lymph node groups that are significantly involved are the left inguinal and the left para-iliac nodal groups, which are presenting as very large nodal masses. but there is also a significant involvement of the para-aortic, lesser omental, diaphragmatic, mediastinal, and left supraclavicular lymph nodes. Now, when we look at the pattern of involvement, especially of the intra-abdominal nodal group, it appears to be contiguous, but there are certain important nodal groups that have been skipped and not involved, and these mainly include the celiac node, the perigastric nodes, the periportal nodes, as well as in the thorax, the other mediastinal nodes and the hilar nodes have been spared. The other important thing is that there are repeated biopsies of the inguinal nodes that were done, and all of these seem to suggest that there is evidence of possible granulomatous inflammation. If you remember, the first biopsy in December 2019 conclusively made a diagnosis of a granulomatous lymphadenitis, and the subsequent biopsy in CMC showed the presence of multiple ill-defined histiocytic aggregates. So these two problems combined together seem to suggest that the disease process in this patient is associated with a generalized lymphadenopathy, which is present as a granulomatous lymphadenitis. There seems to be an underlying granulomatous process that is occurring as a part of this disease. The second important problem is the presence of the parafemoral and para-iliac collections. And what is commented upon in the CT scan is that these collections are in close proximity to the nodal masses. They cannot be distinguished from them. But it is important to remember that collections in the para-iliac region can also arise from other sites. Two very important sites from where para-iliac collections can arise is when there are suppurative diseases involving the vertebral system. So in patients who have vertebral osteomyelitis, spondylodiscitis, there can be suppuration and there can be para-iliac collections. Again, diseases of pelvic bones, pelvic joints, in this case, the left hip joint, all of these could also possibly result in a para-iliac collection. The second important thing is that inflammatory bowel disease, especially Crohn's disease and other diseases where they can be sealed off perforations, can present with these rather long-term para-iliac collections as well. But what we need to remember here is that on clinical examination as well as on radiological imaging, there is really no evidence of any osteoarticular disease. There are no collections in the lumbar spine, in the pelvic bones, in the pelvic joints, and there is really no clinical evidence that makes us think of an inflammatory bowel disease as the main disease process in this patient. So it appears that in addition to a granulomatous inflammation, there is a chronic suppurative process which seems to be originating from the nodes themselves, the iliac and the femoral nodal masses, and an osteoarticular and a GI source for these collections seems to be unlikely. Now, the third important group of problems all seem to arise as local consequences of the suppuration. So the first important problem is related to the fact that the purulent collections are encasing the pelvic vessels. And if they are encasing the pelvic vessels, it is possible that there could be an inflammation of the vessel wall along with some extrinsic compression that could explain the presence of the thrombosis of the left external iliac and the common femoral veins. But it is important to remember that there could also be a prothrombotic state because of the underlying systemic disease, which also could be contributing to the thrombosis. The second important observation that is again a local consequence of these collections is the fact that there is a loss of a fat plane between the left para-iliac collection and the left psoas muscle, but there are no focal lesions within the substance of the muscle itself. There is no hypodense lesion in the muscle, there is no gas, and there are no air fluid levels within the muscle. Now, this seems to be suggesting that whatever disease process is involving the para-iliac nodes, which is causing suppuration, seems to be extending into the psoas compartment, and it is abutting the psoas muscle and possibly causing an early stage inflammation of the psoas muscle. And this is enough for a clinical diagnosis of a psoas abscess. For a diagnosis of psoas abscess to be considered, one does not necessarily have to have purulent material within the psoas muscle itself, but purulent material must be present within the psoas compartment, which is composed of the iliopsoas muscle, the iliacus, as well as the iliopsoas bursa. Now, we also know from history and physical examination that this psoas abscess is clinically significant because the patient complained of painful hip restriction. The hip was in a semi-flexed attitude, which again tends to rule out a hip arthritis, because if there were a septic arthritis of the left hip joint, there would have been pain in a semi-flexed attitude. And again, there is pain on left hip extension, which is a classical psoas sign. So we know that this patient clinically has a psoas abscess. The third important consequence of the local collection, of course, is the development of a discharging sinus tract from where the purulent material has drained out and resulted in a chronic non-healing inguinal ulcer. Now, when we look at the fourth problem is that of persistent fever with a cardiac murmur. Now, there is a systolic murmur that is heard at the upper left sternal border, which seems to suggest the presence of a pulmonary stenosis. Now, this pulmonary stenosis could either be organic or it could be functional. In the history, there is no information on whether there is an ejection click that was present or not, but the presence of an ejection click again would have strongly suggested or would have suggested more of the fact that this could be an organic lesion. This patient doesn't seem to have features that are associated with an organic pulmonary stenosis, especially the tetralogy of Fallot. Now, in the presence of a systolic murmur with persistent fever, the possibility of infective endocarditis does arise, but infective endocarditis as a cause of fever in this patient appears to be unlikely for the following reasons. The first important reason is that the pulmonary valve involvement as such in infective endocarditis is quite rare. It is less than 1% of all the cases. Again, even in patients who have infective endocarditis of the pulmonary valve, pulmonary stenosis with infective endocarditis again is quite rare. As you can see in a case study of nearly 600 patients who had isolated pulmonary stenosis, only one patient had infective endocarditis. More importantly, none of the major and minor criteria for infective endocarditis are being fulfilled in this patient. There were 3 blood cultures that were taken which were negative. A transthoracic echo was done where there were no vegetations and the echo did not show any valvular abnormality in the pulmonary valve as such, and of course a transesophageal echo was not done. So these features seem to suggest that the murmur that was heard is more likely to be functional than it is organic, and we know that the pulmonary area is one of the common sites where a flow murmur can be heard. This is a patient who has 2 reasons which can result in a high flow state and can explain this murmur. One is the fact that he has anemia, and the second is the fact that he has fever. So infective endocarditis as a cause of this persistent fever in association with this cardiac murmur appears to be less likely in this patient. Now, in addition to these 4 problems, the patient also has multiple soft tissue nodules in the lungs, the liver, and the spleen. He is noted to have a significant thickening of the gastric wall, especially in the fundus and the proximal body. But we really, based upon the investigations that have been done so far, do not have any sort of pathological diagnosis as to what is causing the gastric thickening. And he complains of a loss of weight and loss of appetite. So if we arrange all of these problems, we see that these problems can be divided into 2 components. One is that he has a regional nodal suppurative disease, which is resulting in a left psoas abscess and a non-healing inguinal ulcer. But he also has chronic generalized, possibly granulomatous lymphadenopathy with multiple soft tissue nodules in the lung, the liver, and the spleen. And he complains of systemic features of fever, anorexia, and weight loss. Now, what are the possible etiological differentials which can explain this pathological diagnosis? Now, when we look at certain diseases like lymphogranuloma venereum, chancroid, glandular tularemia, cat scratch disease, and Yersiniosis, they are actually able to explain a certain component of this pathological diagnosis, which relates to the nodal suppuration, the psoas abscess, and even the chronic inguinal ulcers. All of these diseases are reported in literature to produce regional suppurative lymphadenitis, with histology showing suppurative granulomatous inflammation and microabscesses within germinal centers. There are also reports of these abscesses draining, forming large non-healing inguinal ulcers. However, these diseases are very unlikely to cause lymphadenitis in multiple regions. A generalized lymphadenopathy is almost never reported with most of these diseases, and the same goes for soft tissue nodules in multiple solid organs. So these are rarely reported, and therefore these differentials, though they do explain the suppurative process, fall short of explaining the entire pathological diagnosis, and I will not be discussing these in the subsequent slides. Similarly, when we look at diseases like sarcoidosis and berylliosis, they are able to explain the presence of chronic generalized granulomatous lymphadenopathy. They also present with multiple soft tissue nodules in the lung, liver, and spleen. Berylliosis, of course, mainly involves the lung, causing granulomatous nodules with scarring in the lungs, can involve the liver and rarely the spleen. But what we have to remember is that necrosis, suppuration, abscess formation, all of these are extremely rare in sarcoidosis. And again, there are really no reports of abscess formation, chronic sinuses, non-healing ulcers that are associated with sarcoidosis. Another important feature of sarcoidosis is that it is usually a symmetrical disease. It is a bilateral disease as far as lymph node involvement is concerned. There are a number of cases case reports where sarcoidosis has been diagnosed based upon inguinal lymph node enlargement. But even in each of those cases, the inguinal lymph nodes that were enlarged were bilaterally enlarged without any suppuration, without any ulceration. So inguinal, hilar, mediastinal node involvement is usually bilateral and symmetrical in sarcoidosis. The other important thing is that sarcoidosis, when it causes soft tissue nodules in the lung, there is a lymphatic pattern of spread that is seen, and so most of the nodules will be seen in the interlobular septa and subpleural lesions. They do not have a random pattern of distribution like in this patient. A random pattern of distribution suggests a disease that has reached the lungs via hematogenous dissemination rather than via a lymphatic route. Therefore, again, sarcoidosis and perhaps even berylliosis, though they do explain a section of the pathological diagnosis, they are unable to entirely explain the entire pathological diagnosis. Now, these are some of the important differentials that can explain the entire, they can explain all the components of the pathological diagnosis. So infectious causes like disseminated tuberculosis, disseminated melioidosis, brucellosis, nocardiosis, disseminated atypical mycobacterial infections, as well as granulomatous disseminated mycosis, especially those caused by Aspergillus species, Cryptococcus, Candida, histoplasmosis, all of these are certain infectious differentials which can explain each of the components in the pathological diagnosis. Similarly, there are non-infectious causes like lymphoproliferative neoplasms, granulomatosis with polyangiitis, eosinophilic granulomatosis, Langerhans cell histiocytosis, as well as certain metastatic solid organ malignancies like gastric and colon carcinomas can also to some extent explain the pathological diagnosis in a more entire manner. Now, in the next few slides, I'm going to be using both characteristics of the patient himself as well as clinical characteristics of the disease processes in order to weigh the likelihood of each of these differential diagnosis as the final diagnosis. Now, when we look at host characteristics, there is no history of chronic glucocorticoid use or any other immunosuppressant use. This patient does not, there is no history of chronic alcohol use. He has not undergone any sort of organ transplantation in the past. And disseminated nocardiosis is a disease which classically occurs in this kind of a host. And therefore, in the absence of these settings, in an immunocompetent individual, it is less likely, though possible, that this could be disseminated nocardiosis. Similarly, this patient is HIV negative. Again, there is no history of immunosuppressive therapy. There is no history of intravenous drug use. He does not have neutropenia. There is no history of him having undergone a liver or renal transplantation. These are the ideal settings where disseminated atypical mycobacterial infections as well as disseminated mycosis occur. Again, these are less likely because of the lack of these characteristics in the host. Thirdly, this patient does not have diabetes mellitus. He has a normal glycemic status. There is no chronic liver or kidney disease, and there is no history of any sort of agricultural occupation. Melioidosis classically occurs in people who have poorly controlled diabetes mellitus, who are farmers in India. And again, this is a diagnosis which is less likely in this patient. Now, when we look at clinical characteristics of each of these differentials, the first important clinical characteristic which is missing is osteoarticular involvement, and this renders disseminated brucellosis a little less likely. The reason is that when we look at reports of brucella causing a psoas abscess, they are almost always related with a spondylitis or a spondylodiscitis. There are very, very few reports of brucella without spine, ilium, or SI joint involvement. Every case report of brucella that we see, including literature, we see that brucellosis, which is associated with the psoas abscess, invariably the psoas abscess arises from osteoarticular disease rather than suppurating lymph nodes. Secondly, there is no cutaneous and skeletal involvement in this patient. Besides the inguinal ulcer, the patient did not have any cutaneous lesions at all. There was also no skeletal involvement on both clinical examination as well as on imaging, and this renders Langerhans cell histiocytosis again less likely. In Langerhans cell histiocytosis, rash is a very common presentation. It can present as scaly papules, nodules, plaques. Sometimes the lesions can even resemble seborrheic dermatitis. Secondly, skeletal involvement is a very important feature of Langerhans cell histiocytosis, present in 80% of all cases. It involves the skull, but it can also involve the pelvis, femur, and ribs. These are osteolytic lesions. They cause pain and are therefore detectable on clinical examination. This patient does not have that. Again, the granulomas in Langerhans cell histiocytosis very characteristically infiltrate the pituitary stalk, patients present with diabetes insipidus, with polydipsia, polyuria, hypernatremia, and dilute large volumes of urine, which are not there in this patient. And therefore, this particular differential is also rendered less likely. Thirdly, this patient on ENT examination had a normal upper respiratory tract. He has no history suggesting asthma. There is no cutaneous involvement, such as especially palpable purpura or livido reticularis. He has a normal renal status. And additionally, the ANCA antibodies are also negative. There is no eosinophilia. Therefore, granulomatosis with polyangiitis, as well as eosinophilic granulomatosis, which again can be associated with necrotizing granulomas, they are less likely. We must remember that 90% of all cases of vaginous granulomatosis have upper respiratory tract involvement at presentation, and 85% of them present with glomerulonephritis, which develops within 2 years of diagnosis, and 50% of them have cutaneous involvement when the diagnosis is made. None of these features are present in this patient, and this therefore renders this particular differential again less likely. Finally, when we look at the possible differentials of a solid organ malignancy, we see that the absence of the presence of the spleen, the absence of ascites and omental deposits, and the lack of a celiac node involvement makes gastric cancers again less likely. Now, there are a few reports of disseminated gastric carcinoma presenting with a psoas abscess with even inguinal node enlargement. And inguinal node metastasis in gastric cancers are quite rare. And the usual theory is that they occur because of an occlusion of the loco-regional nodes, the perigastric nodes and the para-aortic nodes. All of these get occluded by the tumor cells themselves, and there is a redirection of lymphatic drainage via the alternate pathway, and that is how the para-iliac and the inguinal nodes get involved. But what is very, very important is that in all of these case reports, the iliac and inguinal node metastasis have always been preceded by metastasis of it to the celiac node, to the perigastric nodes, as well as the para-aortic nodes. This is missing in this patient. Only the para-aortic nodes seem to be enlarged, but the nodes that are responsible for draining the area of the stomach themselves do not seem to be involved in the disease process. Again, splenic metastasis is very rare in gastric cancers. In general, if you look at splenic metastasis in solid organ malignancies, it's quite rare. The frequency actually ranges anywhere between 0.3% to 6.9%. That is actually a very interesting fact, given the fact that the spleen is a very highly vascular organ. And it is a common both nodal and extranodal site for lymphomas. But when we look at metastasis to the spleen from solid organ malignancies, they appear to be rare. There are a number of theories that have been advanced to explain this, but none of them have been conclusively proven. The most important explanations are the fact that perhaps the splenic artery arises from the celiac trunk at a very sharp angle, which prevents the tumor cells from actually entering into the splenic vasculature. Secondly, the rhythmic contractions of the splenic sinusoids prevent the tumor deposits from actually sitting into the spleen and growing. And the third possible explanation is that the spleen itself provides a very hostile environment to non-lymphoid solid tumor malignancies, possibly because of its immune role. But none of these have been conclusively proven. Now, having said so, splenic metastasis, as far as gastric cancers are concerned, are very, very rare, but they can occur in addition to lung and liver metastatic nodules. But what is important is that all reports with splenic metastasis in gastric cancer describe a very highly advanced disease where the splenic metastasis usually occur at a terminal stage accompanied by multi-organ metastasis. Usually there is marked ascites, there are omental deposits, and most patients die within 8 months. So because of all of these features, the possibility of this disease being a gastric carcinoma, especially because there is that infiltrative lesion in the stomach, which is causing an eccentric thickening of the stomach wall, despite that feature, the possibility of this being a disseminated gastric carcinoma is less. The final differential that is rendered less likely is carcinoma of the colon, and this is because of the involvement of the inguinal and external iliac nodes. Now, why do I say that? There are a number of reports of colorectal malignancies arising from the distal colon or the rectum, which can actually present with suppurative inguinal and iliac node metastasis as well. However, for a colon carcinoma to produce splenic metastasis, in almost every case, the lesion is in the splenic flexure, which is the closest site to enter into the spleen. Now, if in this patient there were a malignancy involving the perhaps the distal transverse colon or the splenic flexure, it would be unlikely for the inguinal and external iliac nodes to be enlarged and involved. And that is why for for this patient to have a carcinoma of the colon involving the splenic flexure, but also having a very, very large significant involvement and enlargement of the inguinal and external iliac nodes is again less likely. Finally, psoas abscesses that usually occur in colonic perforations again occur in colonic malignancies, usually occur when there is a colon perforation because of the malignancy itself. So as a result of all of these points, it is less likely that this patient has an advanced carcinoma colon with distant metastasis. So if we summarize all of the diseases that are less likely in this patient, they include melioidosis, brucellosis, nocardiosis, metastatic solid organ malignancies, granulomatous mycosis, eosinophilic granulomatosis, Langerhans cell histiocytosis, granulomatosis with polyangiitis, and atypical mycobacterial infections. And we are left with the more likely differentials of either a lymphoma or a disseminated tuberculosis. Now, at this point, the most logical course would have been to aspirate the collection, send it for culture and cytology, and perhaps perform a guided biopsy of the iliac nodes or a deep inguinal node biopsy. Now, when we look at the clinical course of this patient under the treating unit, this is exactly what was advised initially. The patient was advised a drainage procedure of the inguinal collection with a deep biopsy. But this plan was withheld because, one, it was felt that the collection and the nodes were encasing major pelvic vessels and there was a procedural risk. And secondly, there was a COVID-19 lockdown. And as a result of which, this procedure did not happen. Patient was treated with a one-week course of intravenous antibiotics. He was initiated on empirical first-line ATT on 22nd of March 2020 and then discharged. At discharge, he continued to have low-grade fever. Now, he was reviewed almost a month later, that is in April 2020. At this point, he complained of persistent fever. When he was reviewed, he was noted to have high-grade fever and he continued to have a purulent discharge from the left inguinal sinus. A CT thorax abdomen was repeated. This showed that there was no significant change in the lung nodule size or number. There was no significant interval change in the size of any of the lymph nodes. And there was, in fact, an increase in the size of the left para-iliac collection, which had now increased from 150 cc to 450 cc. Again, he was noted to have hepatomegaly with multiple ill-defined rounded hypodense lesions. Splenomegaly had increased. There was also an interval increase in the size and number of the previously noted hypodense lesions throughout the spleen parenchyma. And the impression of the radiologist was that overall, these features are suggestive of the disease worsening or progressing. Now, 4 days after this, a pigtail was inserted on 20th of April. The patient was started on broad spectrum IV antibiotics for 1 week. The ATT was continued. Now, the abscess that was aspirated during the insertion of the pigtail was found to be negative for fungal and mycobacterial cultures, and bacterial cultures grew bacterioid species. Now, once drainage was started, the patient's fever subsided, but the patient was not entirely afebrile, and he was discharged on oral augmentin, on antituberculous therapy, as well as warfarin because of the thrombosis of the pelvic veins. Now, 1 month later, that is in May 2020, he again presented with high-grade intermittent fever, this time with Rigers. The pigtail was draining 150 ml of purulent fluid a day. He had tachycardia. He had hypotension. His local exam revealed the same deep discharging wound in the left groin, but now there was a second discharging sinus. There was a foul-smelling purulent discharge and slough on the floor, and there was tenderness on palpation with surrounding induration. Now, these are the investigations that were done at that point in time. You can see the patient had developed a leukopenia, and the pus swabs again grew bacterioids, fragilis, CRO, E. coli, and rhizomucus species. The blood culture was negative. A Brucella serology had been done at this time, which again was negative. Now, this patient's blood pressure was responsive to IV fluids with inotropes. He was given septic doses of hydrocortisone. He was initiated on broad spectrum gram-negative cover. And he underwent an open drainage in May, where there was 100 ml of pus that was noted in the left psoas region, and there were multiple enlarged nodes with necrosis. There was necrotic tissue in the abscess wall. After that, we are told that a diagnostic test was done. We do not know what test it was, but this is the test that confirmed the final diagnosis. So in summary, what had happened was that this patient appears to have had a clinical progression while he was on ATT, and we assume that he was adherent, and we assume that he was on the correct weight-based dose of the ATT drugs. It is possible that there was a paradoxical worsening that could have occurred, but the patient appears to have clinical features of a superadded bacterial infection with bacteremia and possibly septic shock, which resolved with source control, which was the drainage of the abscess, as well as with antimicrobial therapy. And then we are told that an unknown test was done during the drainage procedure itself. Now, when we look at the discussion of the final diagnosis, we are left with the two most likely differentials in this patient. And the question is, does this patient have disseminated tuberculosis or does he have lymphoma as the primary disease? And I'm going to discuss five important clinical aspects from the case, which will help decide which of these two diagnoses are more likely. Now, when we look at the nature of the psoas abscess itself, we see that in patients who have tuberculosis, psoas abscess is not a very common process. Its overall frequency is 3.2%. But what we must remember is, like disseminated brucellosis, vertebral involvement is very common in tubercular psoas abscesses, and it can occur in nearly 65% of all cases. In patients in whom tubercular psoas abscess is considered, one must always look for tubercular spondylodiscitis or a vertebral osteomyelitis. The upper lumbar vertebrae and the lower thoracic vertebrae are most commonly affected, producing the characteristic pod spine. The other 35% of psoas abscess in TB is because of hematogenous dissemination, because of local extension and unknown foci. So that is a relatively rarer cause of a TB psoas abscess. Now, in comparison, when we look at lymphomas, psoas abscesses with lymphomas, especially NHLs, are again rare. So if there's a case series of 400 patients with NHL, 16 of them had a psoas abscess, that's 4%. But 79% of all cases of NHL-associated psoas abscess have the psoas abscess because of an extension from local lymph nodes. That is the most common source of a psoas abscess in a lymphoma. Vertebral involvement is rarer in lymphomatous psoas abscesses, accounting for only 14% of cases. Again, in a very, very small percentage of cases, ranging between 1% to 5%, lymphomas can arise from tissues immediately around the psoas muscle itself, where sheets of these lymphoid cells will be seen encasing the psoas muscle and sometimes suppurating. But this is a very rare extranodal site for NHLs. Now, the second important thing is the gastric infiltration. Now, despite the fact that we have really not had a pathological diagnosis regarding the gastric infiltration, the fact is undeniable that he does have this gastric infiltration, which is significant. Now, when we look at GI, when we look at stomach involvement in tuberculosis, that is very rare. Gastric TB is very, very rare, and 90% of all cases of GI TB involve the ileocecal region where they produce ulcers. Now, in that very small subset of cases of gastric tuberculosis, we see that infiltrative lesions like the ones this patient has are extremely rare. They are 1%. A majority of lesions of gastric tuberculosis are ulcerative or ulceronodular. And in 80% of cases, they look like peptic ulcers. And they are only nodular in 10% of cases. Another important fact is that when we look at TB granulomas, they are found in all the layers of the GI wall. And 45% of all cases have granulomas that are synchronously present both in the mucosa and submucosa. And therefore, argumentatively, it is far easier to get a diagnosis or find a TB granuloma if a mucosal biopsy of the stomach is done. Now, in contrast, when we look at lymphomas, the stomach is a very common extranodal site for NHLs. And we see that as when compared to TB, infiltrative lesions are a little more commoner. They account for 19% of cases. In 31% of cases, the lesions are polypoid. And in 25%, they are ulcerative. But again, the ulcer morphology is quite different. They don't look like peptic ulcers. They are very large stellate ulcerative lesions. But what is also very important is that most of the granulomas in lymphoma have a diffuse submucosal infiltration and perhaps in the lamina propria, but they are usually not found in the mucosa at all. And therefore, endoscopic biopsies have very high false negative rates that are as high as 10%. And what is usually recommended is that multiple, that is at least 10 biopsy specimens with occasionally using large forceps biopsy specimens are needed to actually pick up a gastric lymphoma in suspicious cases. So this is more similar to what has happened in this patient. Thirdly, when we look at the radiology of the lung nodules themselves, the CT thorax shows that there are multiple nodules which have a random pattern of distribution. There are no satellite micronodules. There are no centrilobular nodules. The tree in bud sign is negative. Again, there are no subpleural nodules and there are no septal nodules also. So the presence of centrilobular nodules, satellite micronodules, the tree in bud sign, all of these seem to suggest a transbronchial spread of the nodular disease versus subpleural nodules or septal nodules, which, as I mentioned previously, suggest a lymphatic spread. And these nodules are not found in this pattern of distribution in this patient. This patient has a random pattern of distribution, which seems to suggest that whatever disease is there has entered into the circulatory system and has reached the lungs as opposed to lymphatic or a transbronchial spread. The fourth is the host characteristic itself. Disseminated tuberculosis would be usually expected to occur in immunocompromised patients, so patients who have advanced chronic kidney disease on dialysis, or those who have uncontrolled long-standing diabetes mellitus. But none of these predisposing factors exist in this patient. He is an immunocompetent patient who has no significant past history at all. And the fifth is the therapeutic response itself. The disease continued to progress despite the patient having received 2 months of weight-based ATT. So if we summarize, this patient has a psoas abscess without any vertebral involvement, but he has significant local suppurative retroperitoneal nodal disease. He has an infiltrative gastric lesion where the biopsy findings have been non-contributory. Perhaps they are falsely negative. He has the presence of multiple randomly distributed lung nodules. He is an immunocompetent person, and his disease has progressed while he's on ATT. And all of these features suggest that it is more likely that the patient has lymphoma than disseminated tuberculosis. So the next important question is, if this patient has a lymphoma, is this Hodgkin disease or is it NHL? Now, when we look at Hodgkin disease, it has a bimodal age range. It usually occurs between 20 to 40 years and then after 55 years. We know that extranodal involvement is rarer in Hodgkin disease than NHL. In less than 15% of cases, it involves functionally contiguous lymph node groups. And Hodgkin's disease, there are no case reports of psoas abscess. There is one case report of a rectal abscess, again, because of Hodgkin's disease, where some amount of suppuration has occurred. The overwhelming majority of case reports with psoas abscesses are to do with NHLs. So this is a patient who is 42 years old. He has largely non-contiguous lymph node involvement. There is significant extranodal disease in this patient. He has a clinically significant psoas abscess, which makes the possibility of a non-Hodgkin lymphoma more likely. Now, when we look at non-Hodgkin lymphomas and psoas collections, overall, as I mentioned before, NHLs presenting with a psoas abscess are rare. There are several case reports. There are 20 case reports that are available, but no large-scale observational studies, except the one that I mentioned. Most of the common types of NHLs in these cases are either DLBCL, that's diffuse large B-cell lymphoma, or peripheral T-cell lymphomas of two types, anaplastic large cell or NOS, that is non-otherwise specified. Now, DLBCLs, we know, are the most common NHLs, accounting for 30% of all the cases. The most common extranodal site is the stomach. 30% of all patients have systemic symptoms like this patient had, of fever, weight loss, drenching night sweats. In more than 50% of cases, the LDH levels are elevated, but they cannot be used for prognostication. In contrast, PTCLs are much rarer. Western literature shows that the incidence of PTCL ranges between 4 to 11%. But there are recent studies, including some from CMC, which shows that the frequency is much higher in India than in the West, up to 17%. Of course, in Southeast Asian countries like Japan, it is even more frequent, 70 to 90% of all cases. The most common subtype, nearly 30% of all cases, are PTCL-NOS. GI involvement is less common except for NOS, where stomach is a common extranodal site. So the question is this patient, assuming that he has an NHL, does this patient have a DLBCL or a PTCL? And a very interesting finding is that PTCLs characteristically generate a very vigorous granulomatous host response in involved tissues. We know that lymphomas in general produce granulomas, but PTCLs in specific produce a very vigorous granulomatous host response. And in fact, granulomas can be so numerous that they overshadow the neoplastic lymphoid cells themselves in the background. Usually, when we look at the morphology of these granulomas, they are poorly developed, poorly formed. They are not large and well-defined granulomas like the ones we see in tuberculosis or even Crohn's disease. And they usually are reported as these multiple ill-defined histiocytic clusters. And there are many instances where the disease is misdiagnosed as a granulomatous lymphadenitis, very similar to perhaps what has happened in this patient as well. Now, there are a number of studies that are there which point out to the difficulty in distinguishing between a reactive or a granulomatous lymphadenitis and PTCL, and many of the studies point to PTCL-NOS as a particularly difficult subtype. These are studies as early as 1988 to up to 2001, and many of these studies say that immunophenotyping with CD3, CD4, CD8, which are the T-cell markers, CD19 and CD30, helps differentiating PTCLs from reactive lymphadenopathy and other malignant lymphomas. And so my final diagnosis would be that this patient has a non-Hodgkin lymphoma, despite the fact that DLBCL is the most common subtype. Because of the previous few slides, I would say that it is more likely that he has a peripheral T-cell lymphoma, either PTCL NOS because it is a more common subtype, the gastric mucosa seems to be involved, and the fact that, again, they are commonly associated with granulomatous lymphadenitis-like diagnosis or an anaplastic large cell lymphoma, which again is very repeatedly being mentioned in reports with psoas abscess and large suppurative nodal collections. The other alternate diagnosis would be a diffuse large B-cell lymphoma. So I think that the diagnostic procedure that was performed was a histopathological examination of the biopsied lymph node with immunophenotyping and immunohistochemistry. And I think the information that we would all want at this point is which of these two immunophenotypic patterns did the lymph node biopsy finally reveal? Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Ravikar, for such a riveting discussion. And thank you for taking us through your thought process so clearly. I'll now call upon our senior faculty who have come today to give us a glimpse of what they thought from the case. I'll start with Dr. Dilip. Could you take us through what your thought process would have been?
Yeah. Okay. Thank you, Ravika. That was a wonderful presentation. Very good.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Sorry, may I be a little candid? I like your approach to the whole issue, but I have another different approach. I always look at how did the organism enter the body. I am an infectious, so I'm going more on the infectious disease line, and you alluded to certain infectious disease conditions. And number one is, there are 15 lung injury patterns that are seen with a lung infection. And this patient had two of them. One is a cavitational lesion, and second is a lymphatic spread. So you've got two of those lesions. Now, whatever the organism is, it came into the lung, the microbial antigens caused a stimulation of your T cells on your B cells, perhaps, and caused a kind of a proliferation of these T cells. And I think that microbial antigen is hidden in the macrophages. And the microbial antigen is because the tissues that have been affected as a result of this have been the macrophages seen in the liver and in the spleen. And so therefore, I would look for an organism that came from a route through the, let's say, airways. I know you considered the route through the genitourinary. Difficult to explain on the basis of chancroid, like you discussed very well. The only other organism that can come is when we used to give BCG for the treatment of bladder cancer, you might get a local granulomatous lesion due to BCG. So I would certainly think, in my opinion, that it's the organism came through the lung. The second most important thing, and you alluded to this, is the laudable pus. Yeah, the quantum of pus that you are getting. 500 ml drained at one time, 150 ml drained at another time. And why are we getting this pus? The reason why we're getting this pus is this organism, or whatever it is, whatever the pathology is causing some amount of a necrosis. Or is it apoptosis? I don't know what it is. I think it is a necrosis. And this necrosis, I think, certainly is not gaseous. It's a form of a liquefactive necrosis, caused by whatever the microbial antigen is. The third part of the pathology, as you have expressed, is this it is progressive. You have taken two CT scans, and both the CT scans I will come to later, but two CT scans have shown that it is progressive lesion. And there is no accumulation of other entities. Like when we have an HIV, not this patient is not having HIV, there is no other cumulative illnesses that are coming on. So it is certainly a progressive disease. And the entire duration is almost more than 18 months or even 20 months. And I don't think this person of 42 years, yes, you have alluded to certain carcinomas of the stomach and of the colon and other areas. at the age of 42 and with 18 months of this so-called dissemination is a little unusual. Finally, I want to rest with one statement that everybody is worried, is concerned about this appellation or this terminology, granuloma. Now, when you have this granuloma, I think you should go to the pathologist and discuss with them, what are they seeing? Are they seeing these tightly packed epithelioid macrophages of the so-called tuberculoid type? Or are they seeing something like a necrotizing lesion? So I would go for that. This is, as you said, that it is histiocytic. I think it is a necrotizing lesion. And in the amongst the necrotizing lesions, certainly a gram-negative bacteria you have ruled out, like melioidosis and things like that, because it's not grown in culture. And certainly your Brucella you have ruled out, because the Brucella agglutinin is negative, and it's difficult to cultivate also. And I would go for a, again, for a microbial one, certain as per I thought in terms of actinomyces, because it's on the left side, but it's a little unusual because this is a retroperitoneal structure and the colon is free, absolutely no connection. And so actinomycosis is a very unusual thing. So my bet would be that mole, I would consider histoplasma, particularly because this patient is coming from Jharkhand region. The route of entry is via the lung, and it has spread to macrophages, and it has spread, and it's a necrotizing lesion, and numerous empirical therapies have been done with anti-TB drugs, so it's unlikely to be a Mycobacterium hominis or bovis, and I would say that, well, my diagnosis would look at, because four tissues have been affected. It's a disseminated lesion. Lung, lymph node, spleen, kidney, spleen and liver. I agree with you that thrombosis is because of the low flow state rather than due to a procoagulant factor. So having used all of my data points, I would say that I would consider histoplasmosis as one of my diagnoses. And if you ask me what is the investigation of choice that I would probably do or they would have done and which they could not do, is that, if the cavity, abscess cavity wall was biopsied and you could see the organism, or whether a molecular diagnostic technique was used to identify histoplasma, perhaps in situ hybridization, FISH technique to identify, or a multiplex PCR to look at histoplasma as a possible fungal etiology causing this so-called phenomenon that we are seeing. Thank you.
Sir, I would just like to respond to two of the points that you have made. The first is that I too considered the possibility of actinomycosis, especially because of all these draining sinuses. The reason I sort of thought that it was less likely is because I found it strange that the patient had such extensive lung involvement as far as the nodules were concerned, but there was no thoracic involvement at all. If we look at actinomycosis lesions involving the lung, they invariably tend to involve the pleural cavity as well, and they have discharging sinuses from the pleural space, which was not there. Secondly, I felt that as far as histoplasmosis is concerned, which was also a differential, I felt that the behavior of histoplasmosis in an immunocompetent and immunocompromised person are different. And if this were in fact disseminated histoplasmosis, it is strange that the patient doesn't have any sort of GI lesion, especially ulcers in the oral cavity, no diarrhea, the absence of cutaneous papules, the absence of adrenal involvement. That is why I sort of felt that a disseminated histoplasmosis was a less likely differential.
Thank you, Dr. Dilip, for your insights and for those thoughts. I'd like to ask Dr. M.S. Sheshadri, sir, would you like to make some comments, sir?
Okay, hi. Ravikar, that was a phenomenal presentation.
Thank you.
Very nicely done, very systematic, methodical, and the conclusions arrived at use a lot of logic and sense. But I differ from you in two respects. I agree that diagnosis of a peripheral T cell lymphoma and a diffuse large B cell lymphoma on histological specimens can be difficult. I agree with that. But what was found in this patient's biopsy in CMC hospital was predominantly histiocytes in the biopsy. Okay. Now, there's another curious thing about the peripheral count that I find interesting. Here, the fairly profound lymphopenia. If you look at the absolute lymphocyte count, it has always been less than 500. Where are the lymphocytes going? Now, I have an explanation for this. If these histiocytes that are active at multiple sites have the chemical signals to attract the lymphocytes would home in there and the peripheral lymphocyte count will be low. So my guess is that we are dealing with a histiocytic disorder because the best microbiology laboratory in the country has not identified a pathogen, an infective agent causing the problem. So I would say an infective agent is unlikely. I would completely agree with you that the SOVA's abscess is an epiphenomenon that happened after the biopsy. Now let us come to what has happened to the retroperitoneal region. In the retroperitoneal region, you've got a number of lymph nodes. There is an encasement of the iliac vessels on the left side. The vessels have become thrombosed. You attributed this just to extrinsic pressure by a psoas abscess, which is less likely than a fibrotic process that is compressing the vessels. A fibrotic process in the retroperitoneum can occur with histiocytosis. So I think that's one point I would think is in favor of this disease. And you mentioned about Langerhans cell histiocytosis. There is other non-Langerhans cell histiocytosis, which is often an adult disease, occurs in people over the age of 40, male predominance, slowly progressive disease, multi-system involvement does occur, all right? And it can go on for a very long period of time and escape detection under the guise of a granulomatous disease. So my diagnosis in this patient would be a histiocytosis, even though he does not have the classic other features that you alluded to, lack of skeletal involvement, lack of pituitary involvement. Those are more common in the Langerhans cell histiocytosis. In the non-Langerhans cell histiocytosis, these tissues are less commonly affected. The skeletal lesions may be silent and may only be picked up on a bone scan or on a PET CT. You do a PET CT, you'll find the bones lighting up in a patient with histiocytosis. My guess is in the sick patient, perhaps they did a PET CT, found the bone lesion, and came to a diagnosis. It's a rare diagnosis, I agree, but this is the way I would think about it because I can't explain the severe lymphopenia, number one, and the abundance of histiocytes in the histopathology specimen reported in CMC hospital. I would fully agree with Dr. Dilip, that the first thing you should go in this kind of situation is to go and sit with the pathologist and look at the pathology, histopathology specimen, and try and see what is the best you can get out of it. Do all the immunochemical stains that you can and arrive at a tissue diagnosis, because this is a disease, I believe, that can be diagnosed only by a tissue biopsy. Finally, the psoas abscess. If there is a lot of retroperitoneal involvement, and as part of that, if the sigmoid colon is breached, then you can have a sinus tracking from the part of the lower part of the gastrointestinal tract, which will account for the Bacteroides fragilis and the Escherichia coli that were found in abundance in the pus culture, and the copious pus discharge that Dr. Dilip alluded to may be coming from a small leak from the bowel. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. I'll proceed now to Dr. Katie, sir. So would you like to make some comments, and what would your diagnosis have been?
Please unmute. Let me also congratulate Ravika for a very fine discussion on the topic, and I think it has been very precise and went through the details of the differential. What he has is certainly what you have presented, that he has a psoas abscess. There is evidence of a disseminated spread with multi-organ involvement. Now, what would be, and certainly a granulomatous disease by biopsy. So what I would consider the common, of course, if you say commonness, tuberculosis comes up very high. But I would have thought tuberculosis, if it is a mycobacterium tuberculosis, it would have been diagnosed earlier by various methods. And I do not want to include that as the major diagnosis in this case. So if you leave aside mycobacterium tuberculosis, what is the other possibilities that we have? You talked about, yes, a lymphoreticular malignancy. Yeah, that is one of them. Second is a atypical mycobacteria, which could be, and the third will be an invasive mycosis. I would agree with Dilip that there are many features here which suggest that this may be an invasive mycosis. What would you consider are the most common things would be histoplasmosis, sporotrichosis, and chromomycosis. But out of which, histoplasmosis or sporotrichosis both do exist in India, particularly in the northern sub-Himalayan belt. And we should certainly bring that as one of the major differential diagnoses in this case. And otherwise, as Shesh said, we have to finally come to a conclusion by a biopsy and a culture, or a biopsy with a genetic PCR, or some method of making a diagnosis has been done here. But I don't think a lymphoreticular malignancy is as high a probability as the other, because you felt that invasive mycosis is unlikely because of immunocompromise. He's not immunocompromised. But if you want to bring in a lymphoreticular malignancy, then he has to be immunocompromised. So there is an intrinsic problem with that diagnosis of whether being is immunocompromised or not, if you bring in reticulose as a major diagnosis. Oh, that's my thought. Okay. Anyway, very good discussion.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. Dr. George John, sir, would you like to take a... what were your insights, sir, in this case? So you need to unmute yourself.
Can you hear me now?
Yes, sir.
Okay. I said, just want to repeat, that is an excellent discussion, and I can add only a few points. One is, I'm going to the case history. It's surprising that the CT scan showed a 10 millimeter node in the neck, but it was not detected on clinical examination. So obviously it was very deep. The second is that the first LFT showed a normal alkaline phosphatase in spite of having extensive liver involvement. The second one showed a RACE. It's just observations, nothing to do with the diagnosis. The third bit, CPC is a microcosm of clinical diagnosis. Because you know that there has to be a definitive diagnosis at the end. I remember during my registrar days that we had a patient with PUO who died. And we had a full postmortem on him, including the brain. So when I went to the pathologist and asked what is the cause of the PUO, he said the only thing he could find was the degeneration of the inferior olivary nucleus. Now that sort of a case will never come for a CPC. Because we still didn't have a diagnosis at the end of it. So this has to have a definitive diagnosis based on a test. One thing which I wish you had discussed and maybe discarded is leishmaniasis. He's coming from Bihar. So visceral leishmaniasis is quite extensive there. And you can pick it up with an LD body very easily and can be missed if you don't look for it. So maybe you would have included it in the diagnosis. And second thing, sarcoid, you can get cavitation in sarcoid, but not caseation. So this person had early cavitation, but no caseation. So I don't know whether I could have discarded it that easily. And as you mentioned, quite relevantly, histoplasmosis without adrenals is unlikely. So the CT showed no adrenal involvement. And adrenals are very commonly involved in abdominal histoplasmosis. So having said that, I don't have a definitive diagnosis. I only have a basket of diagnosis, just like you. But I would add on sarcoid and leishmaniasis to the pool. Anyway, well done. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. I'd like to invite all our heads to also give us their views. Dr. Sudha?
Sorry, I'm just talking from Manju's because my phone went off charge. There are a few interesting things I thought was there. One is the fact that the culture grew bacterioids, which means there's probably some sort of a colonic perf or something, that because where did the bacterioids come from? And this was later. So that was one thing that worried me a bit. And the hypoechoic lesions in the liver and spleen, I'm not sure how frequent NHL will present with these hypoechoic lesions in the liver and spleen. Maybe Ravikar has seen that in the evidence. I don't know. Ravikar, did you see how frequently you get hypoechoic lesions in NHL in the liver and spleen? Because that worried me again. But it's an excellent discussion, Ravikar. I really enjoyed it. So that's. But other than that, I think the differentials were all considered. Nothing new came to my head. Other than what has been already discussed. So I have nothing more to add, but these are two things that I wondered about.
Thank you, ma'am.
Ravikar, can I ask you a question?
Yes, sir.
When you said diffuse large B-cell lymphoma,
yes, sir.
Are you referring to the disease that used to be called Brill-Simon's disease, with large lesions in the spleen, which is not a very progressive disease, but an indolent disease? Was that what you are referring to? They can have fairly large lesions in the spleen. It's whole terminology, but I was wondering whether you're aware of that. No.
I don't think so.
But does that cause the diffuse large B-cell lymphoma? Does it cause nodular lesions in the spleen and in the liver, which was described on the imaging in this patient?
So I of course, this is... this is not something I'm very well versed at, but in the literature search that I had conducted, most of the NHLs, including DLBCL, especially when there is extra nodal involvement, do have nodular involvement of the liver and the spleen, and most of the lesions were hypodense. And the two main subtypes that sort of came up was, one was DLBCL, and the other, to a smaller extent, was PTCL.
Yeah, the only patient I had seen with spleen showing such large lesions in a lymphoma was what used to be called Brill-Simon's disease in the olden days. I don't know what they call it now.
Not very sure of that, sir. Thank you. I'll call upon Dr. Anand. So if you're there, to give us your insight.
Can you hear me, Tina?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, so I don't have any... Sorry, there's two mics going on here.
So we can hear you clearly.
Yeah. Can you hear me, Tina?
Yes, sir. Yes.
Tina?
Sure.
We can hear you, sir.
We can hear you.
Tina?
Sir, we can hear you, sir.
Oh, yeah. So, yeah, histoplasma definitely should be included in the diagnosis. I'm thinking about other inflammatory disorders which behave like tumors. So, IgG... four disease, but it doesn't cause a granulomatous inflammation, so it doesn't explain all the other findings. The lymphoma is definitely high on the cards. The reason which I put that up as a strong diagnosis is the ulcerative lesion, this large ulcer. The second, the presence of vascular thrombosis. Infective etiology is causing iliac vein thrombosis is unusual, so definitely my first diagnosis is actually a lymphoproliferative disorder. The nodal mass encasing the vessels, the ulceration, and the venous thrombosis. Thank you. Good discussion, Ravik.
Thank you, sir.
I think the other term used for Alzheimer's was giant follicular lymphoma. You heard of the term?
Yes,
very
sir.
Old term. But there are huge follicles in the spleen, which can mimic a tumor, but they are multiple.
That is a relatively more indolent disease process, is what I understand.
Thank you, sir. Dr. Hansgat, sir, would you like to give your differentials and comments on the presentation?
Yeah, I would still say it was slaughter because Ravikar really discussed it quite well. I really want to thank Ravikar. I mean, it was so logical to the diagnosis that you made.
Thank you.
And I really want to thank all our teachers, all our senior medicine consultants. I think one positive thing about COVID was we could get you all on board. And it was a treat to listen to your thinking process. I thought Ravikar was flawless, but yet we had people coming in with their thoughts, which was more of a treat for each one of us. I would say a disease which has been going on for a long time, say lymphoma, which could cause both the things in terms of immunosuppression and some infection coming as a part of it. Second is a prothrombotic state, which would be multifactorial, both because of prothrombotic state and an external compression, both of them causing the thrombosis over there, could be a composite of both of them rather than looking at just one etiology as a diagnosis. Trying to explain everything with one etiology would be difficult. It would be two things that we can put it. So maybe lymphoma in the background, and I think Ravikar has brought out very beautifully, and whether that has caused the other subsequent to that would be the way I would put it together. But I still want to congratulate each one of you for the presentations and all the contributions which has helped us in our learning process. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. I'd like to call Dr. O.C., who's been there, who says, sir, please tell us your differentials and what are your comments on the presentation.
First is to congratulate Ravikar.
Thank you, sir. Brilliant.
True Auslerian tradition. So fantastic.
Thank you, sir.
I don't have anything much to add by way of differential diagnosis. Few things which stand out in him. Of course, he has a disseminated disease, lymphoreticular system, pulmonary nodules, some of which are cavitating, and stomach wall thickening. I would consider the abscess as a pelvic abscess as a secondary problem, iatrogenic in nature. Like Dr. Seshadri pointed out, he repeatedly grew Bacteroides fragilis in the pus, so that implies that there is a connection between the bowel lumen and the collection. So that is probably iatrogenic problem. For the rest of the problem, most likely it's a normal, healthy, community-dwelling adult with a disseminated process. Lymphoma is high on the cards. The only thing I would consider is that why would you discuss a lymphoma in a CPC? So this is not donkeys, you have to think of zebras. That's one concern. Histoplasmosis, I would certainly have considered, although he does not have mucosal and skin lesions. Skin lesions are more in immunocompromised adults. Other one which stands out is, like Dr. Seshadri pointed out, absence of leukocytosis and lymphocytopenia. Then after going through the whole thing, I think he has a lymphoma with a iatrogenic abscess in the left side of the pelvis, which has also led on to the thrombus locally because of the impaired flow. Once again, brilliant discussion, Dr. Brilliant, really enjoyed it.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. Dr. Ramya, ma'am, there.
Yeah.
Dr. Ramya.
Yeah, I like everybody here. I think Ravikar has done a really brilliant discussion. Thank you, Ravikar. It was really a very nice learning experience to go through the whole case with you. Thank you, Ravika. And I agree with Ravika's diagnosis. I just would like to add that we had done an audit of all the psoas abscess cases in CMC, which had got admitted over 10 years. So this being a CPC, some unusual causes which turned up there were metastasized spindle cell tumor, which had presented like a psoas abscess. And the other thing is, if you look only at the psoas abscess part with the perforation, the other possibility with the granuloma is actually Crohn's, but it will not explain the lung findings and the other things. And if it's a typical CMC, we can always, CMC, CPC, we can always throw the IgG4 disease at it, I think. So other than what Ravika had said so beautifully, and like all our senior professors have said, these are the three things I would like to just add to the, like George also said, to the basket of diagnosis which are available here. Thank you again, Ravika, very nice.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am. Dr. Tambu, so if you're there, any comments? I know that you've been in the background to help us with the CPC write-up, but still, any additional thoughts?
No, I wouldn't add any additional thoughts. Just once more, Ravikar, well done. Thank we really you. Enjoyed your presentation. It was a real treat. So I think we'll, everybody's looking forward to hear what's going to be the next step. So I won't stand between you and the reveal of the diagnosis. So well done, Ravikar.
Thank you, sir. I would just like to sort of respond to, I think, one very important sort of feedback, which is that my attempt in sort of making this diagnosis is to apply the law of parsimony and try to explain every finding to sort of fit into a single diagnosis. And perhaps what is lacking is thinking of each of those two problems as separate but interrelated problems. And so I do agree that if we do not follow the law of parsimony or Occam's razor and say that each of these problems are because of one disease, then of course the possibility of other diagnoses like disseminated histoplasmosis in the setting of lymphoma becomes more likely. And the bacteroids as an organism coming from the GI source. I had explained the bacteroids and the CRO E. coli as a super infection of a long-standing abscess that had not been drained. The blood culture itself had not grown bacteroids, and that is how I sort of explained the source of that organism, because I did not want to invoke an additional disease such as a perforation as the cause of the bacteroids. But I think OC sir can sort of comment on whether that is likely.
Bacteroids has to come from the gut lumen, Ravikar. So like Dr. Seshadri said, the large mass may not have been a very obvious connection, but some connection between the bowel lumen and the infected lesion there.
Yes, sir.
So before we proceed, usually people don't stand around for the end of the movie to hear the highlights or the rights. So I just want to thank Tina and Murugu Bharathi who put this case together, and I think they made a good write-up for Ravika to discuss. And they've also taken on the help of radiology and pathology and some other people who'll discuss further. So thank you to both of you for doing that work, and thank you to our previous heads. It has been a real treat to see you all. Thank you for accepting our invitation to come and speak. Thank you very much. So over to you, Tina.
Thank you, sir. I must say that Nalini did a large part too.
Thank you, Nalini.
So before we go on to reveal the test and the diagnosis, we have Dr. Dawn has taken a poll of what the PGs thought that the diagnosis was. Since we are running out of time, we will, Dr. Dawn, if you could just put up what the poll was. Zoom in, Dawn.
Yeah, it's too small. Can you read?
Yes. Okay. So I think ACE levels, pus culture, neutrophil function test. I don't think this is in any particular order of frequency of the tests. Dawn, maybe you are better to just tell us what this slide shows, because.
Yeah, thank you, Tina. Just showing the poll results from what residents answered for the two questions. What diagnostic test do you think leads the final diagnosis, and what was the most probable diagnosis? And many people felt that AE's pus culture neutrophil function test, PCR test of the pus, MALDI TOF from the pus, biopsy from the inguinal region, tissue biopsy from the surgical specimen may be the diagnostic test. And the probable final diagnosis, some of them thought were sarcoid, mucormycosis, chronic granulomatous disease, histo. I think histo has come multiple times. Hematological malignancy has come. Actinomycete has come. Disseminated fungal infection has come. Mieloid has come. I think so many of the residents were echoing similar thought process what our teachers and Dr. Ravikar had pointed out. Yeah. Over to you, Tina. Tina?
Thank you, Don. I'd like to thank Ravikar for explaining the case so beautifully and going through every section. You've done more than what any, in fact, in real time was done also to a large extent. Thank you for that. And thank you to all our teachers for putting in so many more inputs into the case. So the test that was done was a deep biopsy, as you said, from the psoas abscess, from the wall of the abscess itself. And I now call upon our pathologist, Dr. Santosh Raj A, to tell us what the pathology specimen showed. Dr. Santosh is from the Department of Pathology with a special interest in molecular pathology, cytology, and oncopathology. Thank you, Dr. Santosh, for being with us today. Over to you.
So this was the first biopsy that was sent. I mean, this was the trephine biopsy. So in this, actually, there was nothing that was significant in it. So as we could see over here, there was trilineage hematopoiesis, and all the lineages were normal. As you could see from here, the megakaryocytes that have been marked, and the myeloids, and be it the erythroids as well, they were all normal. And there was no dysplasia, neither were there any granulomas, or any hemophagocytosis, if at all we are expecting that. And there was neither any increase in immature precursors or in atypical lymphocytes, nothing to point towards any leukemic manifestation. So moving on, this was a second biopsy. This was a core biopsy from the left inguinal lymph node, which had pointed out towards histiocytic aggregates. So as we could see from here, the marked one being the outline of a vessel. So the ones immediately surrounding it are all histiocytes, and there are no definite multinucleated giant cells, or I mean any Langhans type giant cell, nor was there any caseous type of necrosis to point definitely towards a granulomatous, a necrotizing granulomatous inflammation. But still, these were histiocytic aggregates, and they were almost looking like centered around a vessel. So in context of this, even a possibility of a vasculitis was entertained as in the final report, but stains done at this time didn't reveal any organisms, be it fungal or mycobacterial. So as we could see, these histiocytes still look normal. They do not look like abnormal histiocytes, or like how some of our panelists thought maybe it could be a histiocytic disorder, but these histiocytes, as you could see, their nucleus cytoplasmic ratio looks normal, and there's no increase in mitotic activity, or neither is there any pleomorphism. So these are just normal looking histiocytes, just forming ill-defined aggregates without formation of a coalescent or a tight formed granuloma. So this was a second biopsy. So these are the marked ones which would just represent well-defined histiocytes, and we can not see a giant cell nor any areas of necrosis. So moving on to the third biopsy, the one that actually clinched the diagnosis, this was the excisional biopsy. And as we have been seeing even from history and radiology of towards thrombosis, the same thing would have led on to these areas up top, which actually resemble a coagulative type of necrosis. So these are necrotic areas wherein you don't get to, we don't get to see much viable cells, but these rather the same time are not the type of caseous necrosis. So this is just more like infarct type necrosis, maybe because of the thrombosis that has been happening in the adjacent areas. So on the other hand, the one area below these areas are the ones which are looking viable, which we could see just lymphoid cells. So moving up, going up to the magnification power, we could see over here, these are just lymphocytes. And number one, the architecture of the lymph node was effaced. And these are just lots of sheets of lymphocytes, most likely medium-sized lymphocytes. And if we could look at the ones that have been marked towards, these lymphocytes are not the perfect round shape like a normal lymphocytes. Rather, these do have an irregular nuclear contours. And some of such also show mitotic activity, and they do have a clear cytoplasm, which is a little significant in the overall context. So predominantly these cells are the medium sized cells, as we could see from here, and they do have a clear cytoplasm. And among these, there were quite a few large cells as well. So it was not a monomorphic population, but rather a mixed population of both medium sized cells, admixed which were a few large cells with this vesicular nuclei and a prominent nucleoli. So these cells, we could almost take it like a mononuclear Hodgkin cell. So coming back once again, even in these areas, we could still see these histiocytes, histiocytic aggregates. As we could see the ones pointed, these are all histiocytes which were still seen within these the same areas, which had those atypical lymphoid cells. So putting everything into perspective, the lymph node, number one, it was not a reactive lymph node to begin with because it had effaced architecture. And then looking at the cells, it was not just large cells. So diffuse large B-cell lymphoma, if at all, would not be up high on the top of diagnosis in this because it's not a uniformly large cell. And the thing is, there was a variable background as well. Along with this medium-sized cells, there were also a few other neutrophils, a few other lymph plasma cells, and occasional few eosinophils as well. So putting all this into perspective, the differential that we could think of would most likely be a T non-Hodgkin lymphoma, because a B non-Hodgkin lymphoma usually would recapitulate any of the lymphoid follicles. If it's a follicular lymphoma, it will resemble like a follicle, and the marginal zone lymphoma will be seen in the marginal area, and so on and so forth. But this was predominantly diffuse architecture, and there was a polymorphous population of these atypical cells. So moving on, immunohistochemistry is inevitable to characterize these atypical lymphoid cells. So to begin with, we started with CD3 and CD20, three for the T cells, and as we could see from the picture on left, it was diffusely positive in all those cells, meaning it is most likely, it is a T non-Hodgkin lymphoma. And then MIB1, just to show how aggressive or how much of a proliferative tumor this is. So MIB1 is fairly high, I would say, up to 50 to 60%. So meaning it's an aggressive T lymphoma. So moving on, so the next thing would be between whether it's a CD4 positive T lymphoid infiltrate or a CD8 positive. So now we have here, the one up to on left is a CD4. So these atypical cells are all predominantly positive for CD4. So once again, if there was a mixture of a CD4 and CD8, it could be a reactive population. But here, CD4 being the predominant population, it is a atypical T lymphoid infiltrate. That much we can say for now. So moving on, we do know the recent WHO classification with regards to T non-Hodgkin lymphomas. And fairly just rearranging it, we could come to a conclusion as to if the patient shows a leukemic manifestation, then these would be the possibilities. So from this case, we do know that there is no leukemic manifestation at all. Rather, there was maybe a contradicting lymphopenia as well. And there were extranodal manifestations do have a certain specific lymphomas, but this patient's disease was predominantly nodal. There was nothing to do with a primary focus on GI tract, neither in the nasal cavity or anywhere else. So extranodal manifestations could be ruled out for the time being. So cutaneous manifestations, as Dr. Ravikar had pointed out, there was absent, literally no macropapillar rashes or nothing else pointing towards any concomitant cutaneous manifestation as well, which really helps, especially in the case of a T non-Hodgkin lymphoma. Because if there were any cutaneous manifestations that were present, then the possibilities of this entire lot should be considered, which would make use of more immunohistochemistry. But clinical history here was helpful because there was absence of cutaneous manifestations, and the overall context, maybe it's a nodal manifestation. The possibilities of differential would be these five. The one first thing would be a peripheral T-cell lymphoma, not otherwise specified. But then this is more like a diagnosis of exclusion. So once we exclude the other differentials. So moving on, now we know it's a T non-Hodgkin lymphoma. So next thing was a CD30. So CD30 will be usually positive in a case of anaplastic large cell lymphoma, as that was also one of the differentials considered. So, but here we could see 30 is negative in all the large cells that we could see over here. So anaplastic large cell lymphoma is out of the differential. So the next thing, as we could, if I could go back, we could see over here, there are T cell lymphomas with a T follicular helper phenotype. So just to do markers to see whether there is a follicular helper phenotype being expressed in this atypical lymphoid population or not. So these markers were done, CD10 and BCL6, which both point towards a TFH, a follicular helper phenotype, which were both negative as we could see from here. And then CD21, 23, just to look at whether there is any normal residual follicular dendritic cell. So if you could see the picture on far left is how a normal lymph node with a 21 and 23 would look. When it expresses 21 and 23, that is how it's supposed to look. So, but in our case, we can see there is absence of 21 and 23, meaning there is absence of both the normal follicular cells and also extra follicular dendritic cells, which would usually be present in a case of an angioimmunoblastic T cell lymphoma, which is also one of our differentials. So just to summarize up, the trephine biopsy, as we could see, there was no leukemic involvement, and usually your high-grade TNHLs can show a concomitant hemophagocytic syndrome, secondary HLH, which was not seen over here, and granulomas, if it was a disseminated TB, might have shown up, but we didn't see any granulomas in the trephine, and there was no eosinophilia as well. Eosinophilia sometimes can be seen as a part of a paraneoplastic syndrome, even in a case of a TNHL. So that was also not seen. So the first core biopsy, which just showed histiocytic aggregates without any possibility towards a possible definite granuloma. But the one that clinched the diagnosis was the excision biopsy, the deep inguinal lymphoid biopsy. And we saw those were atypical cells, which showed a mature T-cell phenotype. And then the most important thing is a PTCL NOS. We basically, it's sort of an exclusionary diagnosis. So once you exclude all other diagnosis, this is the leftover diagnosis, because all other things have a characteristic immunophenotype or a clinical pathological feature. So that is where your clinical history of skin manifestation and also the immunohistochemistry of CD30 and other features help us. So finally, this was the last diagnosis, last biopsy which was done, which was from once again the left iliac region. This region once again showed both granuloma as well as fibrosis, just meaning to say it's a chronic condition. So this was the picture, the one up top on left shows a nice granuloma, epithelial granuloma, we could say for sure. And in spite of, and we can once for all quit the term histiocytic aggregate, because here it is a well-defined granuloma. The one on the right, it's just a foreign body giant cell reaction to just a suture material. So maybe because of prior needling at that biopsy site. So putting all this into perspective, a trephine biopsy was not of much help in this scenario. And the core biopsy, while pointing towards a certain etiology, as Dr. Ravikar had pointed out, in this scenario, especially PTCLs or any TNHL for that matter, can show a florid histiocytic proliferation. That is basically down to the cytokines being expressed because of the atypical cells. So which would lead on to a false diagnosis made of a granulomatous inflammation. So the one that clinched the diagnosis, obviously with the help of immunohistochemistry, was the deep biopsy, which was finally given as a PTCL NOS, a peripheral T-cell lymphoma, not otherwise specified. And before that, a clinical history of excluding all other entities has to be done, and which was done in this case. And that is how we arrived at this final diagnosis. So, yeah.
Thank you, Dr. Santosh, for that extensive presentation. Our next speaker is Dr. Aparna, who will be from the Department of Radiology. ma'am is a professor of radiology and will be discussing the imaging findings of this patient and telling us her differential based on imaging.
Good evening, Tina, can you hear me?
Yes, ma'am, we can hear you.
I think everything has been discussed. I don't know whether we should really go through it again. Only some things, what people had asked, some questions, I thought I could answer those things. Somebody asked, Dr. Seshadri asked about liver and spleen involvement in lymphoma. So we do see this quite often. I'm not really sure about whether it is in any specific types of lymphoma, but we often see liver and spleen involvement. And another thing about in pathology, when they said about no other organ involvement, so definitely the here multi-organ involvement is there, no, liver and spleen, and the lung had those lesions. And other things in radiology that was little atypical is, so liver spleen involvement definitely can be explained, and the necrosis in the nodes is the atypical to be seen in TB, to be seen in lymphoma, and it's more commonly seen in TB. But aggressive lymphomas can show, like now the MIB index was very high, so we are thinking it's an aggressive lymphoma. So aggressive lymphomas can show the necrosis. And the necrosis is not only in the inguinal and iliac nodes, which could be explained by the thrombosis itself, but even like there were some peripancreatic and periportal nodes, which I think did not come out in the initial discussion, but these also show actually necrosis. So other nodes are also showing necrosis, which cannot be explained only by the thrombosis. Another point was the stomach involvement. So stomach involvement is not very definitive because the stomach is not well distended. So sometimes when it is collapsed, it may mimic thinking that there may be some wall thickening, but it may be there. So this is the area which is looking like it is thickened. So it may be real or it may not be a real finding. So I'm not very sure about the stomach involvement. One more point that was being discussed was whether there was any connection to the bowel because of the bacteroids in the collections in the para-iliac region. So the para-iliac region, the collections, it's actually looking on imaging like as if these are just necrotic enlarged nodes, which are like so enlarged and necrotic rather than separate collections. So it is within the nodes that these collections are there. And these are very close to the sigmoid colon. So this is the sigmoid colon here. So they're just next to the sigmoid colon. But we are not really seeing any direct communication, but they're immediately next to the colon. And there is no air pockets within these nodes to suggest that direct communication is there. So those were some of the points that were being discussed. I thought I can just address those points based on the radiology thing. It was a really excellent discussion, Dr. Ravikar.
Thank you very much, ma'am.
Thank you once again. Dr. Santosh said, our final diagnosis in this case was a peripheral T-cell lymphoma with a possible disseminated tuberculosis. So there is the detail to which Dr. Ravikar has discussed this case. There's nothing much left to add. Our differentials went on the same lines as what Ravikar had said. The only thing with this patient was that we were very restricted in what we could do for this patient because we were at the beginning of our lockdown and we couldn't get procedures done, and there was no way of getting anybody to operate on this patient at that time because we had cut down manpower, cut down services. So I think one of the biggest learning points from this case was that we should have chased the diagnosis and we should have probably been more aggressive at getting those biopsies done early. Thank you, Ravikar, for such an interesting discussion and for so many learning points throughout your discussion. I now call upon Dr. Anu Kurula from the Department of Hematology to tell us about this disease and about what has henceforth happened to the patient.
Thank you, Tina. Can you hear me?
Yes, ma'am, we can.
Okay. You can see the slides? Can you see the slide?
Yes, ma'am. Yes.
Okay, right, yeah. So, Ravikar, before I start, that was really an excellent discussion, and I'm very privileged, I think, to have been here for the last hour and a half. So, very quickly, I'll just go through what happened to this patient. Santosh has already shown the extent and the number of lymphomas, that T-cell lymphomas that are have been described. Just to say that these are very heterogeneous clinically as well as histologically, and you know, they can going from mycosis fungoids, subcutaneous panniculitis T-cell lymphomas, hepatosplenic lymphomas, and this last one is showing a NK T-cell lymphoma. The clinical picture can really be varied when in T-cell lymphomas compared to the B-cell lymphomas. And this is a figure actually showing the incidence of T-cell lymphomas, which are present in what they describe as Asia. Just to know that this comes from the Far East, and the Far East population of is very different from us. They have a very large number of extranodal T-cell lymphomas compared to what we see. We do see, this is from our center, 250 patients we have treated, and most of them actually are in the PTCL NOS category, or the, you know, the diagnosis of exclusion. A large number of them are also ALK negative ALCLs, and you can see the proportions of the other cases. So PTCL NOS is the most common T-cell lymphoma which we see and treat here. So just to know, in T-cell lymphomas, the nodal T-cell lymphomas, the outcomes are very subtype dependent. The outcome in ALK positive ALCL is far superior to the all the other subtypes, and peripheral T-cell lymphoma has a 5-year survival of around 30 to 40%. So it's based on the outcomes between these two groups. The ALK positive ALCL would just receive chemotherapy alone, and all the other subgroups we would give CHOP chemotherapy with the addition of etoposide, because these lymphomas tend to be resistant to anthracyclines, and we will consolidate with an autologous stem cell transplant. So transplant, it has been shown, it improves the outcome in these T-cell lymphomas in first remission itself by around 10-15%. But you can see here that in this figure, the gray line actually shows the ALK negative ALCLs, the outcome has improved, but everybody else, the outcome despite transplant is quite dismal. So this is the data from our center, about 250 patients we have treated with the nodal T-cell lymphomas. And just look at the figure on the right, the 3-year overall survival is around 30% in these patients. Here I've actually just highlighted on the left side, you can see that of all the patients treated, only about 30 to 40% of them actually go into remission. So it is a challenge treating these patients, not least because they present with advanced stage disease. So this patient came to us in May. He had advanced disease, stage 4. His prognostic index was placed him in the high intermediate group because he had advanced stage disease with a very poor performance status, high LDH, and advanced, yeah. So he also did have a thrombosis of the deep vein thrombosis, external iliac and common femoral vein. So we gave him anticoagulation in addition to chemotherapy. The initial plan was to give him CHEOP therapy, and if he went into remission, to do an autologous transplant. And because he was so debilitated, we gave him a first cycle of abbreviated chemo, that is with CVP. He did fairly well with that and actually walked into the OPD the second time to get the remainder of the chemotherapy. He actually did surprisingly well with this protocol. So we gave him a total of 6 cycles. This was how he did. This was an interim assessment which was done in August and showed good disease. Actually, we continued the ATT for 7 months. That's what, along with giving the chemotherapy as ID had advised. But his disease, soon after starting the chemo, the ulcers regressed, the nodes regressed, and he did very well. Unfortunately, at the end of therapy, his PET scan that was done showed metabolically active disease, both in multiple nodes actually, as well as the lung. So in this condition, many T-cell lymphomas do not respond, and we'd go for some form of intensified therapy, which was done in his case. We gave him salvage therapy, and at the end of that, in November, he actually had significant regression of disease. He just had one single metabolically active focus, which appeared to be infection. It was again in that iliac region, there was a sinus tract, and so he went for a debridement of that. There was granulation tissue, that is the last slide which Santosh showed with the foreign body granuloma, but there was no evidence of malignancy. At this point, he was planned for an autologous transplant. Unfortunately, there are a lot of challenges in transplanting these patients, partly because they do not mobilize adequate stem cells. So in this patient, he was a poor mobilizer and we were not able to proceed with the transplant, though he was in remission. Next option was to do an allogenic transplant, which is a consideration in these poor prognosis patients, but he did not have a matched sibling donor, and I felt that the risk of a haploidentical transplant would outweigh the benefit in his case. So we decided to actually put him on maintenance therapy with lenalidomide. Now, there are many drugs which are available nowadays for the treatment of T-cell lymphomas. Most of these are not available to us. We'll have to wait and see how he does at the end of, I guess, if he's in remission for a year or two, that means he's got an extremely good prognosis. Thank you. Just to answer just a couple of questions about the lesions in the liver and spleen, it's very common to see patients with advanced lymphomas having